Chief, and today I'm going to be doing a comparative analysis between American opera and its counterparts. Now, before I start, if you're watching this live on Facebook, welcome. Hope you're here for some fun. I do have a corresponding playlist that I posted pictures with in my post description. So if you want to follow along with the icons on Spotify, go ahead and get your phone out for that. The only time you'll be encouraged to have your phone out and on during a presentation, so take advantage. That being said, let's dive right on in. So I want to talk a little bit about this big question here, and that question is, why opera? Why do we care about this art form? What's the point of all this? Why did I do this presentation? Because the majority of the general public sees this as elitist, unrealistic, and irrelevant. So, you know, what's the point? Well, we have a couple good quotes here. This first one says, "It seems that as long as there is a story to tell and ideas to be aired, opera will flourish. It is, after all, simply a heightened, multi-sensory means of making sense of the painful, glorious, complicated truths about the human condition." And I went a step further and I actually Googled, why does opera matter? And this is what I got. It says, "Opera matters today because it has things to say that can't be said otherwise. And these things are complex and deep, and they need to be said in long form by a whole voice and a whole body, without mitigation. In the world we live in today, that is in short supply and it matters." Now, these are great quotes, but you still might not be convinced. You still might think that opera that started back in the 1600s is kind of irrelevant. So we'll take a little look at this timeline to kind of get an idea of how this all started. Now, back in about 1597, the composers had this really great idea to take stories that people were familiar with, like mythology and Greek dramas, and put them to music. And these musical forms were, in a way, it was called through-composed. And so there was just kind of a meandering musical idea. There was nothing really solid melodically or tune-wise that you could cling to. But the stories were things that people knew and were familiar with. Now, if we take a step forward to the 1700s, we get a really big step in the idea of an opera. And that was the birth of the aria. And for anyone here who might be an opera newbie, an aria is pretty much a solo song given by a performer to express their feelings, their thoughts, what they might be thinking about doing or planning on doing, how they're responding to things, etc. And the form that came up with this was called the da capo form, which you might recognize more as kind of the ABA. So you would sing a little bit about one thing, sing a little bit about the next thing, and go back to your first point. Now, in the 1700s, we got the first of our big four opera composers, and that was our friend, or maybe not our friend, Mozart, depending on your opinions. And he was really, really big in pushing this new art form that was getting very popular. A lot of these operas in this time were based on playwrights, stories that people knew and knew what was going on with those. And we also have the development of kind of two branches of opera. We have our opera seria and our opera buffa. And the way you can think of this, I like to think of seria as serious. These were very, very dark and kind of deep, scary operas sometimes. Then we have our opera buffa, which is our comedic operas. I like to think buffa, buffoon, I'm an opera buffoon, all goes together. And in this time, people like to base these stories on kind of servants and masters. Maybe the servants or the peasants got back at their masters by outsmarting them. And this is really something that people in the 1700s thought was just super funny. Take a step forward now to the 1800s. This wrapped up the classical period and started the romantic period. And here we had another big step in the progression of opera, and that was the bel canto. And bel canto means beautiful voice. So around this time, the big focus in these compositions was showing off the singer's ability. What could the voice do? And we had the next two of our really big name opera composers here. And that was Verdi and Wagner. And Verdi was very well known for composing melodies that were recognizable and easy to hear. And if you think back to the 1600s when things were through composed, there wasn't much to cling to musically. And Verdi changed that a little bit. And if you see the little listen icon with the one and want to take a listen, that's an example of a real catchy Verdi melody. And our other big one that came up in this time was Richard Wagner. And his big contribution to the development of this art form was the leitmotif. And this was the idea of taking a small melody and using it to symbolize something throughout the performance. Now, this could symbolize anything from a character himself, an object, or even an idea. And if that seems a little foreign to you, I want you to think about Star Wars. And I bet you can think that there's a very specific melody that comes up when the Death Star appears, or a very specific melody that represents Princess Leia. And these are all techniques that were based on the leitmotif by Wagner. Now, in the 1900s, we got the last of our big four opera composers, and this was Puccini. And at this time, opera stories went from these playwrights and things to really the nitty-gritty kind of tragedy. These were based on people in poverty, and the big one that tends to come to mind is La Bohème. So let's keep on going for opera time. And by the mid-1900s, politics was starting to work its way into opera. People were taking this as less of a way to simply show entertainment, and now we're using it as a way to make a political statement. And as we start to look forward towards American opera, you'll see that many of these traits in traditional European operas tend to reappear. So if we travel right on over to the United States, we'll see that in 1935, what was considered the first American opera, Porgy and Bess, premiered. And you might notice that it actually premiered on Broadway. And so during this time, there was very little distinction between American opera and its musical theater counterparts. Many performers would perform in operas or musical theater. Performances would be put on in Broadway or in opera houses, so there was not a lot of distinction. And in this time, American composers really wanted to take a stance and develop American opera as its own genre. And they thought that by throwing out the European ideas and going for weird, experimental, funky, modernist stuff, that they could just set it apart, they could just make this new genre. Unfortunately, people do not tend to like weird, funky, experimental stuff. People like tunes they can recognize and stories that are good. And because of that, and because of World War II happening in this time, American opera was really struggling. Thankfully, for American opera, by the 1950s and 60s, there was a boom. And this happened due to composers such as Carlisle Floyd, Giancarlo Minotti, and Samuel Barber. And these composers realized that by doing crazy, weird, experimental stuff, people didn't like that. So they went back to the European method that Verdi and Puccini followed of having compelling stories and tunes that people could cling to. And so really from that point onward, American opera has been progressing further and further as a new art form that pays mind to where it came from. Now, anybody who has any experience watching movies, reading books, etc., knows that there's some really good ones out there, and there's some not so good ones out there. And that goes the same for opera. So we want to know, we have this art form, but what makes it good? What sets an opera apart as a superior form? Now, the first quote is from a baritone that I spoke to, Keith Ferris, and he says, "A good opera should have an engaging story, a smart libretto, characters the audience can identify with, music that is flattering for the voice and drives the drama, but could also stand on its own." Now, composer J.K. Hagee tells us, "The opera should be of a time and yet timeless." I think this is a very profound quote that helps to translate this art form across many generations and many stories. Our very own Dr. Rivers at the University of Tulsa says, "The opera should have a certain dramatic arc to it." And mezzo-soprano Kirsten Chavez tells us that if you can marry melody with a compelling story, then you have a recipe for success. And for anyone listening and listening to excerpts, you'll see that number two here is an option if you want to take a listen. Now, I spent a lot of these last couple slides talking about traditional European operas. And that might be great if you're fluent in Italian or German or know a lot of mythology, but chances are it might not be that easy for you to connect with this art form. And I wanted to ask the question, what can we do as Americans to help connect to opera better? And the first thing that will help us connect to this art form is having settings that we know and recognize. Many older, more traditional operas took place in Europe, and in time periods that we may not be as familiar with. The next thing that can help us is the melodies with American appeal. A lot of the times, we want to hear music that sounds familiar to us and is something that we can really connect to and cling to as we listen. Next, we can connect to opera through stories or themes that are familiar. As I've been mentioning through the opera timeline, oftentimes these were based on playwrights of European descent telling European stories about things such as masters and servants and dukes and duchesses. And for our culture, that's not something that might be as familiar for us. And finally, the biggest of all the barriers is language. Oftentimes people are turned off by the idea of opera because it's not in English, or even if it is in English, it's a very almost pompous feeling European version of English. So let's take a look at some examples of American opera as a way to connect. And the first one we're going to talk about is American settings for American operas. Now, compared to stories that take place in Seville or in Italy or Germany, we have stories that take place in the Midwest. We have stories that take place in somewhere such as Charleston, South Carolina, and I've actually seen the place where they base the opera Porgy and Bess. There are operas that are written in English that take place in Appalachia, such as Carlyle Floyd's Susanna. We have stories that take place in the West, the Upper Northeast, and even the West Coast. Now, I guarantee you that you can connect and know something about at least one of these locations. And I think something really special about Oklahoma is that it combines a little bit of a lot of these into it. So that's one way that we can start to connect with these operas, is knowing they take place in a location we're familiar with. The next big thing that can help us connect to American opera is the melodies that we might know. Some of the musical elements and instrumentation of American opera. Vocally, American operas really like to focus on folk melodies. And there's two listening examples here. That feel free to take a listen to from Carlyle Floyd's Susanna and see if you can kind of pick out the folk-like tunes in here. The next one that's really interesting is the inclusion of things like school fight songs. And chances are that if you've grown up in the United States, you've been to some type of high school sporting event or college sporting event and have heard a school fight song. It has a very distinct sound and it's something we can relate to. Finally, our big one is church hymns. American operas love to take advantage of the church hymn style, the harmonies, and the lyrics that we are often very familiar with. Again, there are listening examples here if you want to check them out. Now, I don't want people to think that American opera is throwing out entirely the ideas of older operas. There is still that bel canto, beautiful singing type of style that's really emphasized, a very lyrical element to the sung words. And as Keith Ferris tells us, it is still rooted in Western European tradition. So American opera is not straying from more traditional operas, it's merely incorporating elements that we can connect better with. Now, instrumentally, we tend to stick very closely to the more Western European style. Sometimes operas are written for smaller groups and colleges and may use a chamber orchestra, which can still give immense expressive possibilities, but takes out having to have so many members of an orchestra. Oftentimes, single wind instruments are used, and strings are often emphasized as the core sound. Other times, instruments such as harp might be added for a shimmery effect, and banjo and harmonica can even be added to really emphasize that folk music feeling. Now, if you remember from our opera timeline, a lot of the stories that traditional operas were focused on were things that people of the day were very familiar with. Many people studied Greek mythology and folklore. Playwrights were coming out with books and stories that were being performed, and many Europeans really, really knew what was going on, connected with these stories. And that might be difficult for us when we're in a different culture than that. And so American operas have done something great, and that is taking American stories and put them to music. Some of the cultural elements of American opera that are often emphasized are themes of religion and Christianity. And you'll remember from the previous slide we talked about hymnals, and church songs often very prevalent. And this is one example of how the Christian faith and religious aspects are often incorporated. The next one that often appears in American opera is sports, especially football. And I'm not a big sports person myself, but I love to see something that's an integral part of our culture being worked into these newer operatic performances. The next one that likes to show up in American operas is the small town experience. And this isn't to say that every American opera focuses on a small town, but many times they do focus on that more rural, more impoverished setting. And that's something that many Americans can connect to, whether that's a situation you've been in, or you live in a small town, or even if you've studied American history, you're probably very aware of that vibe that small towns have. And finally, American historical events are often used as a basis for these stories. Now, you'll also see that I have some literature and film inspiration up here. And like I've been saying, playwrights and stories have always been a big draw for people to write operas about. And this has not changed with American opera. There are operas about Moby Dick, of Mice and Men, the play cycle Morning Becomes Electra, and even the Christmas movie classic, It's a Wonderful Life. And even if you've never read or seen any of these productions, I guarantee you, when you hear the words Moby Dick, you say, oh, the white whale, I know that. When you hear of Mice and Men, you say, oh, John Steinbeck, I've heard of him. And this is another way that we can connect more to operas, by having these stories that are familiar to us. And finally, the big one, language. This is my favorite quote from one of my favorite children's shows. Prunella from Arthur says, opera is nothing more than people in silly costumes singing in a language we don't even understand. And this is a huge misconception that people face when thinking about opera, is assuming that it's only sung in foreign languages. But I have some good news for all of you. American operas are sung in American English. The excerpt that is listed up here is from Carlisle Floyd's Susanna, and you can really tell that the dialect that is chosen is meant to be representative of American English and the American English language. Oftentimes, colloquialisms are employed when writing these librettos. Syncopation is often used to imitate American speech patterns, and so listening to these performances when they're sung in our native language takes out the middleman of having to read subtitles and reinterpret something foreign into something familiar. It's right there, and we're able to hear it and understand it. Now, singing in American English can present some challenges. As a singer myself, I can confirm that English is much harder to sing in and make sound nice. Keith Ferris tells us that the mixed vowels that often lend themselves to be beautifully rounded bell tones everywhere in my voice. But in general, I sing most freely in American English. There's no filter to deal with, and I'm not having to think of what to say or how I'm saying it. And I think this is a big part of helping us to connect to these operas, is knowing that we don't have to go through a translation process to understand the story and to understand what the characters are conveying. conveying to us? Now, the libretto is a very important part of the opera. This is the words of the opera, and I would say that in some instances it may be even more important than the music. Now, sometimes American composers and librettists may do as Wagner did and write their own libretto, and there are benefits to this. There is much more control over how the story is told and how it pairs with the music. One example of this is Dr. Joseph Rivers of TU, who has written a libretto for several of his works. Now, as we mentioned in the previous slide, these operas are sung in American English, so there's a bit less pomp than our European counterparts. It's something that's almost more casual and easier to relate to. And Jake Cady tells us to really emphasize the importance of a collaboration with your librettist. This is very important to making sure that your opera is cohesive and is easy to connect to when you pair those words with the music. And as we've been seeing, American stories are based on things like plays and novels who were written by Americans. These are things of people who have grown up in this country and who understand what it's like to live this experience. And I think that's really important in helping us develop this art as something we can relate to. So, I'm going to take a bit of time here to talk about American opera versus Broadway. And I want to preemptively say I'm in no way saying one form is better than the other. This is merely a comparison. A lot of people often wonder what makes these two things different. They're both sung in English. Oftentimes, they're told about American stories. You can think about the hit Hamilton. So what makes Hamilton different from Carlisle Floyd's Susanna? And I think that's actually a valid question, because they do have similarities. The first big thing that differentiates opera from Broadway is the use of technology. Now, operas are performed with a live orchestra in a pit below slash in front of the stage. The singers are singing purely with their body. There's no microphones or external amplification occurring. Meanwhile, Broadway is often done with microphones and is sometimes done with pre-recorded tracks of music. And in another sense, Broadway performances tend to have a bit more technology involved in the general productions overall. Again, this is merely a difference in productions, both require skill. Another differentiating factor between the two is the amount of spoken word. Operas are almost entirely sung. Even dialogue portions are done in more of that through-composed style or recit style that is still on notes, but is not a full aria or choral movement. Whereas Broadway tends to have fully spoken parts. And a little interesting thing here is when you think back to the 1930s, when there was still no clear distinction between opera and Broadway, we're starting to see that again with these American operas, as it's really beginning to cross the line between the two. And this occurs in a lot of instances that while classical singing is being performed and no microphones are being used, more spoken dialogue is being included in newer American operas to help push the drama forward. And I think this is a really great way that we can help kind of combine these two art forms into one that people are able to connect with. The next one that's a bit different is the scope of the story. American operas and many operas tend to focus on a larger force at work influencing a few people. These tend to go into the very deep intimacies of a situation. I don't always mean that in a sexual way, but it can happen. But really, to have the story impact a few individuals and see the depth that impact goes to. Broadway stories tend to be a bit on a grander scale and more theatrical, probably hence the musical theater aspect of it. And finally, we have our musical differences. Opera training and Broadway training are both very difficult, very admirable things to study, but they are different. As we've said before, Broadway requires using a microphone, and oftentimes people can perform many, many times in a week, and have many, many rehearsals because they're not having to use their body as their only projecting method. And this is something that does differentiate it from opera. As we see here, our good pal Douglas Moore, composer, tells us that opera to succeed must be good theater. And so, although there is a distinction between these two, there are many things that each can give the other. And one of these is the memorable melodies. And this person here tells us that American opera, when it was still in its formative years, and people were being experimental, it needed to have those memorable melodies like theater in order to succeed. So we can see that these two art forms have played off of each other greatly. Now, we've talked a lot about the stories that make up opera and how the stories are chosen. Now let's talk about who sings them. And I want to talk a little bit about both the voice types and their stereotypes. So we'll begin by going through our four very basic voice types. We start with our bass and baritone, which is our lowest male voice type, followed by the tenor, our higher male, our mezzo-soprano, which is our lowest female, and our soprano. And for many traditional European operas, these voice types were often paired with a sort of character archetype. For example, sopranos often sing the heroine of the piece, such as Mimi from La Bohème, Violetta, and Pamina. Alternately, mezzo-sopranos are often given pants roles or play young men, or are known to play kind of the hussy character. The big one is Carmen, kind of the seductress form. Our tenors, most often in traditional European operas, sing the hero or the love interest, such as Alfredo or Mario Cavaradossi. And finally, our bass baritones were often cast to sing an older man, or maybe a sinister character, such as Mephistopheles. And so in these older traditional forms, there were very set types of what voice parts went with which type of character. And you know, there's some pros and some cons to that. Some pros is that the audience and composers often have an expectation for what the voice should sound like and what the character should sound like. As Dr. Rivers tells us, age often comes into play, a deeper experience and a nostalgic feel is typically paired with a lower voice type. There's oftentimes an intuition for the characters when composing these operas, and you expect something to sound a certain way and to look a certain way, and you want to cast something and write something that fits that mold. Composers in the past tended to be very familiar with vocal abilities and vocal ranges. This meant that when they were writing pieces of music, they would be able to judge how high up their soprano could sing and how low their soprano could sing and write to fit that voice part. And following these vocal archetypes keeps us true to the older European ideas and traditions. Now, as with everything, there are some cons to this concept of vocal stereotypes as well. And the first thing is that they might be a bit predictable. If you see a performance and there's a heroine, you'll probably guess and say, oh, I bet that's sung by a soprano. And that's nothing wrong with that, but you see it coming. Keith Ferris tells us this might even be getting a little outdated. There might not be a lot of diversity in the characters when they're stuck in these little boxes of what they can and cannot represent. Sometimes when you take away the vocal archetype, as has happened in a few American operas, you might even be asked for a non-existent vocal role. Kirsten Chavez told me about the role requested as Jo in Little Women, which was, I believe, a lyrical contralto? It was something funky, but it did not exist. And she says that modern American operas may ask for things that are difficult to achieve. So as we can see here, there are some good things about having a vocal stereotype, and there are some bad things. Keith Ferris tells us he thinks it's time to do away with them. He says opera is going to survive, it needs to start looking for new stories and new characters, much more authenticity and diversity. He says we don't have to throw the baby out with the bathwater, but we've got to start stretching the boundaries. By have to say I agree with him on that.
Now, I'm a mezzo-soprano, and I have to have a little moment here to talk about the mezzo-soprano stereotype. And I found the funniest line I've ever seen about opera when I looked this up, because typical roles for mezzo-sopranos have this triad that's associated with them, and that is the witches, bitches, and britches triad, which I've been laughing about that all week. It's so funny. For a real-world example of this, we have Azucena, the old gypsy woman from Il Trovatore, the rather conniving, almost seductressy type Amneris from Verdi's Aida, and our sweet Cherubino, our little pants roll. As far as American operas go, when this was first getting started and people were still on that kind of borderline between musical theater and opera, a lot of these older stereotypes were being followed. There was an opera, Regina, that was written around that starting time period. And I would say, based on the quote described Regina, she really fits the bill for our mezzo-soprano triad here. And this was a mezzo-soprano role. Now, Regina, this character, was described as ruthless, greedy, and a manipulator. And I would definitely say that fits the stereotype. A lot of these early American operas tended to follow that European tradition, and that was using the mezzo as a counter to the soprano character. There was a lot of clashing that occurred in a way to kind of push the drama forward. Like our previously mentioned Amneris and Aida characters, operas such as Ballad of Baby Doe also relied on having kind of the naive, sweet, charming little soprano sung by Baby Doe, and the more thoughtful and a bit deeper and darker mezzo-soprano role. And it really wasn't until the play The Crucible, which was then turned into an opera, came along, that the mezzo-soprano stereotype began to shift. And this was taken with the role of Elizabeth Proctor, who was sung by a mezzo-soprano. She was, in the performance, still a married woman, which still kind of goes with that older aspect of this character type. But she was actually written in this performance to be a bit of a moral compass. And it was around this time that we started to see that the mezzo-soprano stereotype didn't always fit that triad of things. So let's take a look now at these newer American operas. Now, it's not so unusual for opera to have a mezzo-soprano lead. American operas today presents a relatable and well-rounded woman as a mezzo-soprano. They are not confined to that stereotype triad. And one of the potential reasons for this is the mezzo-soprano vocal range really provides a dramatic stance. It's one of the widest vocal ranges of all the voice parts, and for composers, that's something you can really take advantage of. Instead of having to write for a small set of notes that you might want to cover, you can really up the drama in your composition by having that wide range. And this may be a reason that mezzo-sopranos are now being written in roles that 200 years ago might have been composed for a soprano only. And I wanted to do a little bit of a comparison between some mezzo-soprano lead characters versus their more stereotyped older counterparts. So for our witches category, the sorceress from Dido and Aeneas, and the gypsy woman Azucena, these were both seen as kind of hags or older women, kind of spooky and creepy. And we counter that with some new mezzo-soprano leads. Sister Helen Pergine, a nun from J.K. Hagee's Dead Man Walking, and Sharon Falconer from Elmer Gantry. Both of these women were seen as religious figures. This is very counter to the kind of spooky witchcraft business that was in older operas. The next one I want to talk about is actually a comparison between the mezzo role and the soprano role, but I thought it was worth mentioning. The opera Tosca focuses on the opera diva, Floria Tosca, and she's a very stereotypical diva character. I mean, she is throwing fits all the time, lots of drama, not a great image to be portraying and very superfluous and surface level almost. And we counter that with the mezzo-soprano lead role from the opera Great Scott, which also focuses on an opera singer. And this singer, Arden Scott, sings many arias that discuss her inner feelings of doubt in her abilities, her questioning of her place in the world and her role in these operas. She has much more depth and is much more relatable than kind of that propped up flimsy character. And finally, as we mentioned before, our character Elizabeth Proctor from The Crucible as a moral compass mezzo-soprano versus our very well-known hussy seductress Carmen. So as you can see, as opera has progressed, American composers have been able to take these stereotyped roles and break free of them. And I think that's something that is much more enlightening and much more dramatic and relatable for the audience. There are some other notable mezzo-soprano roles as well in American operas. And so, I want to use this last slide to help convince everybody, no matter what side of the fence you're on, whether you're an opera traditionalist, a huge Broadway fan, or both, about the exceptionality of American opera. As we've seen, it honors the European traditions of vocal technique and orchestration. American opera is real opera. It presents stories that fit the dramatic arc that opera requires. There are comedies and there are tragedies in American opera, and all of these are very powerful pieces of movement that fit right in with our more traditional European counterparts. And what's nice nowadays is composers are not so boxed off, and they have a larger freedom to choose from different vocal timbres. And this helps to kind of break free from these stereotypes. There's much more character depth that can be attained. As we said, the freedom from the confines of traditional vocal roles allows for new and multifaceted characters. We're able to break free of those stereotypes and develop characters that are much more real. They may be both good and bad at all levels, and I think that's something that's very special and unique about American opera that our European counterparts may be lacking. Next, American history and culture, as we've seen, has a gold mine of content that fits operatic settings. We've seen stories that have taken place across the United States in many different time periods. We've seen stories that have been based on literature and movies, as well as American historical events. And we can obviously see through composers' and our singers' viewpoints that American ingenuity is present in all aspects of American opera. So, conclusively, we can say American opera is its own genre. It is different than musical theater, but it's still genuinely operatic. American culture, melodies, stories, and language are emphasized, and these are great ways that any American listening to these operas can really connect with these stories and start to appreciate this art form. American English and libretto of familiar dialects can increase the accessibility. By taking out that foreign language barrier, it's much easier for listeners to understand the stories and to know what's going on and appreciate. And finally, diversity in vocal roles and characterization provides depth. American opera has really taken a stance to create characters that are well-rounded and aren't stuck in the confines of a vocal archetype so much. So, I would like to wrap up with some thank yous, of course, to Professor Rafer for guiding me along this research project and for many, many years of guidance. I'd like to thank composers Dr. Joseph Rivers and Jay Peggy for letting me pick their brains for information on the compositional process, as well as the singers and proponents of these new American operas, Kirsten Chavez and Hugh Ferris. And of course, thank you so much to everyone tuning in. I